Might and Magic 2 was created by New World Computing and released in 1988. It is a role-playing game, and of course, a sequel to Might and Magic 1. The official name is Might and Magic 2, Gates to Another World. The plot is to save the troubled land of Kron. Most of the chaos is caused by the evil character named Sheltum, who is actually a eunuch guardian created by ancients, and he went haywire. While defeating Sheltum is the main goal of the game, there are many different subquests. So here we're presented with the main menu, where we can start the game. If you played Might and Magic 1, you can actually transfer your characters over, but we're going to be randomly generating them. You have this nice little animation of a die being rolled. Toward the bottom of the screen, you can see all the attributes of the character. And of course, they are randomly generated. To the right, it shows you which number you can press on the keyboard in order to use that specific class. After choosing your class, you choose your race. And then followed up by the alignment. Alignment does affect what types of equipment you can equip, believe it or not, and you can also choose your sex, which is important as well. You start in Middlegate in the inn, and this is where you add your characters. There are some pre-made characters, but I never really like using them. So once you add up to 6 party members, you can exit the inn and begin exploring. The blacksmith is one of the first buildings you'll find and you'll want to go in, where you can buy all kinds of equipment. Weapons, armor, and miscellaneous. After you make your purchases, you want to, of course, equip, so you can view your character and begin equipping. Moves from your backpack to the equipped section. As you move on to other towns, you'll find blacksmiths, but they'll have different equipment. And usually they'll have pluses toward the end, which means, of course, they're better. You can sell your unused equipment at the blacksmith. There's a quick reference menu option, which allows you to see the party members at a glance. It shows their current hit points, spell points, and what condition they're in. There's also a menu option to exchange position, which is very important during combat. The members toward the front get attacked more readily. There's also a menu option for changing the game difficulty level, as well as delaying text messages. And you can turn sound off, which is nice because the sound in the game is quite lacking. You'll find training grounds where you can increase your party members' level as long as you have enough experience and gold. When you do level up, especially spellcasters, they'll gain new spells. They don't get all the spells in the spellbook. Priests, for example, may find various spells that they're missing from their book when they visit a temple, and here they can purchase those. It's only a specific level, however. So you'll have to go around to different towns in order to find all the spells. Magic users must join the Mage Guild in order to buy their spells, and it can be quite expensive. Once you do, you'll be able to purchase various spells at different towns again. If you visit the tavern, you can purchase food and drink. All towns have taverns, but the types of food and drink they sell vary, the names at least. And they can be quite funny, such as red-hot wolf nipple chips. You can also tip the barmaid and then listen for rumors and get little tips. Sometimes the clues are quite cryptic and other times they're very helpful. This gives us a position we should find interesting. You can also buy food all you can carry for the whole party. Food is very critical in the game because it allows you to recover hit points and magic points when you rest. Without food, this doesn't happen. Besides the tavern, you can also get food by finding it in various places on the map. Here we found some large fruit trees. The overhead map area is called the Plains of Peril. You can, of course, explore and you can find other towns. You can't move to all terrain tiles, for example rivers, but this ferry crossing can help you cross. Mountains normally can't be navigated either, nor can dark colored trees. I'll describe later in the game how that can be traversed. Sometimes you'll be in the dark and caverns, and you can use lanterns to brighten it up. You'll also find special clues on dungeon walls. These are very useful to help you complete quests and progress in the game. You'll find miscellaneous things such as statues in the towns and street signs, which will point you in certain directions. You'll run across locked doors, and you'll need either a robber or a ninja to unlock them. Sometimes you'll set off traps. In fact, you can keep randomly triggering traps on the same door if you keep failing to unlock them, which is quite odd. You'll run across earthquakes on the overland, which will damage the party. You can get lost if you're trying to explore an area and don't have a special secondary skill. You'll walk into traps. You'll find poisonous juice bars, such as the one on Murray Island. You can accidentally bathe in a pool of acid, again, on Murray Island. Stay away from Murray Island. No, seriously, there's some important things there. You can accidentally stumble into radiation zones, which can actually disintegrate a party member, which is a horrible status to be in, obviously. The term is eradicated in the game. You can step onto bubbling lava pits and be killed. Combat is the biggest portion of this game where you'll be spending your time. So the way it works is the bottom of the screen shows your party member names. If they have a check mark next to them, they're within melee range and they can attack with a melee weapon. Otherwise, they can use the shoot command if they have a ranged attack. Spellcasters, of course, can cast spells, which you have to know the spell level and number. You can only attack the monsters that have check marks next to them toward the top of the screen. On the right side, you'll notice it kind of gives a status of the monster, whether it's injured, it'll say hurt, or if it has a special status such as being weakened. Ninjas can actually critically hit and cause more damage. I never figured out why, but sometimes only one of your party members can attack in melee range. It seems quite variable. So after you win combat, you get experience, and sometimes if you use a search command, you'll find a chest. Now, there's sometimes so many monsters that it shows +2 or +7 or whatever toward the bottom, and they won't show up until the ones above have been killed. You can exchange position in battle in case you need to move up one of your party members to get closer. So after combat, sometimes you'll do a search, and you will not find any treasure. It really varies based on the types of monsters you kill. Other times you'll find chests, and you can just try to open it, find a trap, detect magic, or leave it. Sometimes when you open it, there's no trap. That's quite risky, though. They usually are trapped. For example, here's an explosion of electricity. Then it presents you with the gold and items that you find. You can try to detect and it'll tell you whether it thinks there's a trap or magic on it, but you're almost always going to want to open it. Sometimes you'll find nice items such as a helm +2, which gives you 2 extra armor class over a normal helm. Only thieves and robbers can pick traps, by the way. You'll sometimes find weird things such as a ray gun +6 or a magic meal, which incidentally just gives you food when you use it. The one thing that's a little bit annoying is you can't tell if your character is the wrong class for the item. It doesn't put a special symbol next to it like Wizardry does. You'll find potions such as a force potion to increase your might, which is temporary. You'll find things to increase attributes like your accuracy from this exacto spear, which is permanent as long as you have it equipped, or this mighty whip, which increases your might. You'll find items like the magic charm, which I'm assuming increases magic resistance. Your alignment determines what plus type items you can equip. For example, this neutral character can't equip a +5 item. And I found this cool sword and this character can't equip it. Really annoying. You also run into some very annoying enemies, especially toward the beginning of the game. It's extremely difficult. Here I stumbled in the original town into these jugglers, and they just juggle the whole party, and they're killing me. There's nothing I can do about it. Extremely annoying. So that's one of the things I'm going to warn you about up front with this game, is it's extremely hard to start. Some enemies will frenzy and do damage to the whole party, but then collapse when they're done. Others will explode with the same effect. You'll fight dangerous spellcasters that can wipe you out quickly, or cloud dragons, which have major area of effect. Then you'll run across weird things like these dancing bones, where every time I would try to attack it, the only person that could hurt it was a female character. That took a while to figure out. And cursed corpses could only be attacked by male characters, unless I use spells. Some monsters just do tons of straight damage, and you'll get your butt kicked that way. Even having really powerful characters, you're still always in danger of dying. You can be disintegrated by spellcasters, which is the worst status in the game. And then you'll be wandering a dungeon and all of a sudden run into an ancient dragon, which will decimate the party. Have I mentioned how hard this game is? I had very powerful party members when I ran across this dragon, and I still couldn't take it. It wiped me out in just a few rounds. So that's one thing that is good about the game, is you can play this for probably over a year and still keep progressing. If the going gets tough, you can flee combat. You can do it before combat begins, or in the middle of combat. If you wait until the middle of combat and run, it's a lot harder to get away, and anybody that died, of course, will be dead when you get away. It moves you to the safest square in the game, though, on that map, which is nice. So you're going to be doing lots of grinding in this game, just trying to level up your party members. I've spent weeks grinding these party members, trying to get them more powerful. And then I made a decision. It's time to cheat and use a hex editor. So I modify the roster.dat file. The way I do this is I found out, for example, how much money my party had, typed in the decimal value to convert it to a hexadecimal using the calculator. Then I looked for the reverse values of those hexadecimal number. And that is because I'm on an Intel processor and that's how it's stored. So I modified the numbers to the appropriate values I wanted and then restarted the game. And then I had mad, insane amounts of money. So you'll run across set encounters in the game that will always be there at a certain position, in addition to random encounters. Here we find some mad peasants that are upset with us. Or, for example, the city jail. Well, it did warn us, it said danger. Or authorized personnel only. Frozen monsters. Gee, I wonder what's in this door. You can surprise monsters, such as these hill giants playing volleyball, and gives you a chance to do whatever you want first. There's an arena in the various towns where you can use a ticket to get in to fight monsters. It's a good way to build up your party quickly. If you view your characters, you can actually see which spells you have in your spell book. Very nice feature. Works for priests or clerics, as well as magic users. So there's area type spells you can cast, which will hit quite a few monsters. And then there's some that can only be cast outdoors, such as Moonstrike, which will damage the enemies, but also restore your hit points based on how much damage you did. Very useful spell. Clerics can turn undead, which destroys them, essentially. Incidentally, sometimes I'll say priest, I really mean cleric, and when I say magic user, I mean wizard. So there's also spells you can cast, such as weakness, or encase enemies so that they're paralyzed and can't attack you. You can silence magic users so they can't cast spells, or use a spell like prismatic, which sometimes sucks and just puts monsters to sleep, even though it's a powerful spell. You can cast spells to disintegrate enemies, which either disintegrates them outright or just causes damage. And you can, of course, heal your party members in the middle of combat, which is a priceless ability. You'll eventually run out of gems because some spells require gems to cast them. So you'll have to view other party members and then trade the gems from, let's say, your fighters or robbers to your magic users. And for some reason, sometimes spells will always fail indoors. I was not able to find out why this was the cause. You can use special equipment that have magic abilities, like this voltage bow. Those always seem to work. They never fail, even in areas where casting always fails. Now here's some funny graphics. I found this nasty witch. You can see her boobs bouncing up and down and twitching as she's casting her spells. Or you'll find these crazed natives in bikinis. I think the game designers were a little bit perverted. They're my kind of guys. So here you'll find these anti-magic zones, which I know for sure was a problem. Could never cast a spell here, even though it was not indoors. So after you're done with combat, the best way to get your hit points and magic points back is to rest. Usually you'll want to do this in a safe area, otherwise you can be interrupted. If you do rest, you have to recast any magic spells that you had working. If you're in a dangerous area, there is a guard dog spell that can be cast to allow you to sleep restfully without encounters. There's a wizard eye spell which shows an overhead map on the upper right. You have levitate spell which can protect you from various traps. One of the coolest spells is called Lloyd's Beacon. It allows you to save a specific position on any map. So you can set the new position, go elsewhere, anywhere in the world, and then cast Lloyd's Beacon to return to that position. Really cool feature. There's a fly spell, which essentially teleports you to a specific map area, and you appear in the safest square of that area. If you have a cartographer skill, there's an auto mapping that can occur as you pass through different places. There's also a town portal spell, which will take you to safety in one of the towns. You can remove poison, and incidentally there's items that can do these things too, such as the cure-all wand. And of course, if your characters die, you can raise dead. If you have a powerful cleric. Now earlier I mentioned you can't go through mountains normally. If you have the mountaineering skill, you can. You can also find an associated skill for passing through the thick trees I mentioned earlier. So there's an example of the cartography skill at work. The gladiator skill makes your party members stronger. And incidentally, each character gets to choose what skills they want to learn, and you can only have two of them. Here's Arms Master. You can become a diplomat. All kinds of skills. It's fun figuring out what they do. I found a special building called Brain Detox, which can remove you of your secondary skills. There's a poor man's portal, which you can pay some gold to be transported to another town. And you'll run across castles in the game. In order to get in, you have to have the appropriate key, otherwise you fight castle guards. At this point in the game, you'll find that the castle guards aren't that hard compared to other enemies. You can also stumble across hidden caves and do some exploring there. In some areas of the game, you'll find random advice. You'll find all kinds of really weird things in this game, such as a guy that will transport you to a palace dungeon so you can attack monsters. Or you'll find random Kewpie dolls distributed in this castle, which incidentally work at the circus, allows you to increase your abilities. You'll stumble across dragon's lairs. And you could be in an area where you'll find a wishing well, which will temporarily increase your personality to 65. So you can see there's just lots of weird random things. Statues that have lava grenades hidden inside them. Now earlier I mentioned the keys. The keys are quite expensive to buy and they have different colors. You'll find red, white, black. This one's 50,000 gold. You'll find set encounters where you can save people, such as the struggling victim, or these characters that have been taken hostage by crazed natives. If you save some of them, you'll actually be able to hire them. You have to find the inn in which they're going to stay, enter, and press the space bar, and it'll show you hirelings. Really cool feature of the game. This allows you to get up to 8 characters instead of the normal 6. When you view them, you'll notice that it shows a cost per day, so they do cost you. Just one thing to keep in mind. But having 8 characters makes your party much stronger than just having 6. Here you'll notice how much gold we have, 25,042. After resting, now we're at 24,722. So it can be quite expensive if you rest a lot. But one advantage is, if they're spellcasters, hirelings have all spells. You don't have to find them. Now there's a lot of mini quests in the game, such as finding this gold goblet. So when we do, we return it to him. He gives us experience and treasure. So it helps the game to not feel so linear, because you can go on all these different side quests at the same time. Here's another example. We find this king who wants us to do him a favor. So we say sure, and he actually gives us options. Okay, what kind of quest do you want to go on? So he wants a quick flail. Got to find it and return it to him. There's a tour boat you can go on to take you to Murray's Resort Isle, which I talked about earlier. And you'll find there's a cave on the island, and Murray's vault is there. And he gives us a warning. Don't take his treasure. Well, gosh, you know, that's like being a little kid in a candy store. So I went ahead and took it, get a ridiculous amount of gold. But then later I looked at my characters and I noticed all their attributes had gone down to 5. The developers put in a lot of comedy, such as fanciful Feldkarb fountain flows full as fluttering fairies frolic fictitiously. Flick a farthing? An old wino belches. The snow beast has a secret lair in the city walls. Or the suggestive barmaids, "Would you like a sampling of my stuff?" The jokes of the days are kinda goofy. Pin the horns on the dragon. I found this quite funny, and I wasn't sure if it was supposed to be, but this ogre was saying, "Everybody's always picking on me because I'm not smart. Will you trade something that you have for something I have?" And I kept looking, and it was nothing, so I think he didn't have anything. So the joke was on me. So overall, what did I think about Might and Magic 2? Well, if you like games that you can spend months, if not over a year, making progress on characters and doing lots of grinding and completing quests, this game is awesome. It's the game for you. It's very difficult to get started, though. And it can remain difficult if you stumble into the wrong areas. There's lots of funny statements and comedy in the game, which is always a plus. There's lots of areas to explore. There's quite a few maps. There's a wide variety of monsters you can fight, and the graphics are pretty nice, especially for the time it was released. There's cool futuristic monsters like this robot, or Iron Wizard, as it's called. So, I really do recommend this game for anybody that loves role-playing games. There's a wide variety of magical items you can find in the game, and it's quite randomized. It's very impressive. New World Computing also made quite a few enhancements to the game and features compared to Might and Magic 1. The only real negative feature of the game is the sound quality, but you can turn that off, so that's not a big deal. So I hope you enjoyed this review of Might Magic 2, and I'll see you next time.